So, Promare, we finally get to it. Yep. Here's the deal, right? Studio Trigger, the makers of such fine anime as Kill La Kill, Little Witch Academia, etc., etc., etc.
The studio that saved anime.
Yes. They made a full-length animated motion picture.
Now, this is their first one.
And as we say, if there's an anime movie in the theater...
That's not a sequel?
Even if it's just like Brooms, you should go see
Brooms.
It.
Yeah. there aren't that many anime movies that are feature-length, full production value, released in theaters, and are not a sequel to like Pokemon or Yu-Gi-Oh! Or something.
Yeah, not like One Piece movie 12 or some shit like that.
Yep,
right?
the second piece.
Or, you know, compilation movie of existing anime TV series. Right?
Yeah.
Ones that are original stories, you know, things like that. They're pretty rare.
So if you're an anime fan, just see them all.
If you're an anime fan, you know, it might be hard to go back in time and watch all of them, but you should go back in time and watch all the great ones. It won't take that long. There's not too many.
Yeah. And if you live in a major city in the U.S., they're all in the theater.
Right. It used to be that, you know, back in the day, you could only see them really at, like, in New York at, like, we used to go to, like, IFC or stuff like that, right? But now, thanks to what it called the Fathom Events and whatnot,
yep.
You know, a small company, a small distributor like G-Kids or Funimation can now, through that Fathom Events, put their movie on the screens in theaters around the country for like one or two nights only.
So it's not even like, oh, go to Manhattan to the weird theater one night only. It's like, go to the movie theater we normally go to in Queens.
Yeah, we went to just a normal old multiplex that shows all the... You know, but it's like, all right, they're showing the dub on one night and the sub two nights later, and then that's it.
They got you back. They know what's up. They know.
Yep.
So you can go see the sub, which is the appropriate and correct thing to do.
You may or may not have missed your chance to see it in the theater in the U.S.
I saw some talk that in certain...
There are still some screenings out there, I believe.
In some markets, they extended Promare's theatrical release because it was popular.
I think it's made like $1 million at the U.S. box office.
It's doing well as far as I can tell.
It's doing well for a extremely limited run non-English anime movie in the U.S.
Yep. So before we get into the full review, the TLDR version is just go see it.
Of course.
Like, just automatically, just go see it.
Even before I saw it, I would tell you that because, like we said, it's an anime movie.
But now that I've seen it, go see it.
Yeah, seriously.
Like,
so all I knew was that this is a movie by Studio Trigger. So I had expectations based on what I know about Studio Trigger, but this basically is even beyond, like, not only did it meet the expectation, it basically was too on target. It is literally Studio Trigger, the movie.
Yep, like the way I put it
is... They went all in on what they are good at and who they are. They didn't try to do anything new. They just did what Studio Trigger does as hard as they possibly could.
It's like the opposite of what happened with Mary and the Witch's Flower. It's like, hey, we're going to make a Ghibli movie, but not be Ghibli. And they made a not that good... Ghibli-esque movie.
Yep.
But this is literally, like Scott said it best, this is Studio Trigger, the movie. And if they made a Promare 2, I would go see it.
Yep.
It's, the way I would describe it before we even get into the details, is that is, you know, like an anime movie has like the first act, the twist, the second act, the big climaxy scene, and then the denouement. Take that big climaxy scene and literally make that the entire movie and never fucking stop.
Pretty much.
There's like a few scenes where it slows down a little and they're not even that long. This movie just it just shoves anime into your face as hard as possible. Take the biggest action scene in Giant Robo and make that an entire movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved every second of it. The other thing is it's the plot is there are firefighters.
The plot is nothing. The
plot
is
there are firefighters. And there are fire terrorists.
Yep. The whole world, the plot is actually something weird happened that we can't explain.
Yep.
Where some people were suddenly on fire. The entire world got set on fire, literally. And the post-apocalyptic, you know, reborn society.
Firefighting is really
there
important.
There are still some fire people around. So there are, the societal structure has basically firefighters who go out and deal with the fire-causing people, as well as a separate Gestapo-like police force that arrests the fire people and imprisons them. And then...
That Gestapo literally starts arresting people who are obviously immigrants effectively.
Yes, they have like,
they use ICE weapons, literally.
Yep.
And if you
there
think,
is a
oh,
non-white worker in a restaurant making pizza, he's making the best pizza, and all he wants to do with his firepower is make the best pizzas, and then they find out that he is a, you know, fire person, and they come and arrest him while he's working there making pizzas.
Like, if you...
And all the racist people in the restaurant are like, oh, I don't like this pizza anymore, and leave. Except for the firefighters who aren't racist.
There is zero ambiguity that it is ICE.
No, but yeah, it's the plot is not much of a plot.
Well, the plot, so...
It's basically the plot in they terms need of, to set things on fire and have giant robots.
Yep, but the plot in terms of, like, forget the animated stuff, but like, what the major characters are doing and why? I'm not saying it's complex, but it's more than you would expect. Like, the villain has fairly complex and interesting motivations, like, more so than I expected. Scott, did you ever actually see all of Giant Robo?
Yeah.
All I'll say, if you have seen Giant Robo, the end and, like, what the real plot is and, like, the final moments of this movie are so, so parallel directly to the end of Giant Robo.
I mean, I don't think it's actually... I don't think it comes from Giant Robo. I think it just comes from the same source material as Giant Robo, which is old giant robot animes.
Yeah, right? But more the, like, what did you... It's that, what did you expect me to do with this moment from Giant Robo? Similar sort of situation in Promare.
Yeah, well, I mean, the similar sort of situations in, like, you know, Gigantor and Mazinger and whatever, right?
Yeah, but Giant Robo
all
kind
cut
of
from the same cloth.
Yeah, but Giant Robo really crystallized it.
Uh-huh. Anyway, so yeah, this is not a spoiler, even though it is a thing that happens near the end of the movie. This is a movie where a robot that is so enormous, the entire Earth is on fire. This robot punches the on fire Earth, and the entire solar system sets on fire.
Yeah, that happens.
That is a thing that happens in this movie. It's not a spoiler, because what the fuck can you make of that?
Yep.
But that's the kind of movie you're going into.
You know?
Right?
So
like Gurren Lagann, drill through the Earth, insanity.
Or, you know, like the open, like Giant Robo starts in media res. It literally just starts with this crazy train and a giant action scene.
Yeah, this starts with, after they explain the history of the world briefly, yeah, this building on fire. The firefighters are going with their robots to fight the fire.
Yep, and all the fire, like, hydrants on the street are actually, like, little mecha things.
Yeah, the city is very Evangelion Nerve City, where the whole construction of the city is designed to help fight fires. Same way that, you know, the Nerve City or whatever it's called in Tokyo 7, I don't fucking remember.
Every character is a ridiculous, over-the-top character of something, like, they're as ridiculous as you could possibly imagine.
Right, and a lot of them, they're basically transplanted characters from other Trigger anime, right?
Which I like that.
There's like the big dude,
the Gamagori.
It's just Gamagori. And then, you know, the science-y girl who handles all the tech stuff. It's like, she's obviously just the hat girl from Kill la Kill.
All those characters in the firefighting team, I was getting these vague, like, Bubblegum Crisis vibes a little bit. Like, it almost made me want to go watch Bubblegum Crisis again.
Well, the chief guy with the mustache.
Yeah.
And, you know, plus all the vehicles gave me a lot of Tank Police vibes.
Yeah, it was, especially, there is literally a scene where a fire truck starts rolling through a hallway that is narrower than the truck.
Yep.
That is like the iconic scene in Tank Police.
Tank Police.
The second most iconic scene. The most iconic scene is all the penises, but... This movie is just ridiculous and over the top to the point that I'm hesitant to try to describe anything about it beyond that.
Right. Well, I also got to point out, you know, this is for all the peoples out there. This movie is pretty gay.
Yes, but here's an important point. There is no romantic subplot.
No.
Which that is refreshing. There is a female love interest and a male love interest.
Right, there is a brief scene where they obviously, the camera work is done in such a way to make you think, oh, main character dude is going to kiss, you know, the hot girl that is also a firefighter.
And, like, and she likes him and there's stuff.
But he basically just gets on his motorcycle and drives away. And then there is another scene where it's like, he's gonna give, you know, it's that old mouth-to-mouth resuscitation situation. You know, but... There's basically it is inferred in such a way as like, yes, there's something there, and you know, they don't make it explicit, which
the main character is either gay or bisexual. Right.
It's
just
a shame,
openly.
Right. It's a shame that they don't make it more explicit, but they clearly, via the it is unspoken that, like, yeah, he is not interested in that girl. He is interested in, the dude.
I guess what is refreshing, though, I'm glad there wasn't...
Like in Darling in the Franxx, which I haven't even watched, but I know that, like, yeah, there's a dude and the girl's all bent over in front of him. Here, the two dudes combine in the robot, right? Not that the girl doesn't combine in the robot with the other dude.
Yeah.
Okay, the two dudes combine in the robot.
But I'm glad there's no romantic subplot, only in the sense that I hate that just is in everything, always. The fact that it's not actually a subplot and it's just about these people, but at the same time, their attraction to each other is not in any way hidden.
Mm-hmm.
It's just there. It's also a movie, like, I almost want to just send this to my dad and be like, hey, it's a movie about firemen.
No, it's not.
It technically is.
But no, this is, it's just, firefighting is merely the... facade for which it is a, tactical...
They literally fight fires.
...superhero team.
They fight fires with
fire trucks.
They're
it's like saying, it's like if you just repainted gatekeepers and put, like, a fire emblem, FDNY, on the side of the gatekeeper's vehicles, that doesn't make them firefighters.
The other thing I really appreciated was that it's such crazy over-the-top action. The colors are amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the colors, the lines, like, everything about the aesthetic and how it's animated.
They managed to combine the CG, right, and the regular non-CG animation in such a way, right, that is not the way that Spider-Man Spider-Verse does it.
Yeah.
Right? Like, a new and different way. It's pretty, It just has just like tons of energy in it. I don't know. The one thing is, what was I going to say?
In the early part of the movie, the city itself looks very CGE and sterile.
Mm.
And to the point that I thought that was on purpose and there was going to be a plot around that, which there wasn't.
No.
But otherwise, like, it just looks so good. And in the midst of all this chaos, that what is actually happening on screen still, like, makes sense, which a lot of anime and even live action movies that try to go crazy like that tend to lose this. Like, Transformers movies are the perfect example. Yeah. It doesn't actually make sense what's happening.
Well, I mean, if you go on Twitter, right, and Anna Twitter, people often post, like, these GIFs of like a brief cut from an anime to show you, like, the insane animation in that sequence that somebody did by hand way back in the day, right? You'll always see, like, the one from Macross where it's like, all right, the plane, they're fighting outside the Macross, and then they're in the city, and then they transform, and then they chase, and then, right? And then, there's also the scene where, like, they're falling, and the cockpit opens up, and they fall out, and then they come back in, and he grabs and closes it, right?
Yep.
And it's like these... if you watch those old anime that have these scenes in them, it's like most of that show will be the cheapest, barely moving, cut, low budget animation.
Yeah.
Just talking heads and stuff like that. And then during the action scene, they'll have this one sequence they put tons of effort into that you can then clip and make an animated GIF for Twitter that will be amazing. Wow, look at that incredible animation. This entire movie, you could basically pick any starting and stopping point, and the whole thing will be, Twitter GIF worthy. It's just nonstop anime Twitter GIF of amazing animated action sequence.
Also, I cannot stress enough the absolutely bumping soundtrack.
Right, and if it ever pauses for a moment and there's no action, instead you get, like, breathtaking, beautiful, still background kind of scene.
Every
to look
frame
at.
Of this movie would be a fine desktop background.
Yes.
Every single frame.
Yep.
But the music is fantastic.
Well, I mean, it's the same composer that you heard, in Kill la Kill and all the other Studio Trigger things, with that same kind of energy.
But the animation is, like, really set against the music very well, and the music is varied within the confines of the movie.
Yes.
Which, like, to the point that I've just been listening to the soundtrack at work.
It's on YouTube.
Yeah. The other thing along all those lines is that despite all this nonsense and, like, all this crazy, there's a ton of humor and, like, little jokes and, like, little bits that would be easy to miss. And the movie, and I really, really appreciate this because it's so rare, they trust you to just notice this shit.
Mm-hmm. Like, well, it's so fast. If you don't notice it, you're gonna miss it.
Yeah, but, like, the movie trusts you to notice all these really little jokes without going back and, like, hey, did you get the joke? Mm-hmm. Did you get it?
Yep.
And that,
well, I mean, that's the thing. Is like it moves crazy fast, but it's not crazy fast like Excel Saga or what was that other one that was crazy fast?
The one where this is so long ago. The Elf Princess Rain?
Yeah, something like that, right? Where it's not just like... God,
who the fuck listening to GeekNights remembers Elf Princess Rain?
Isn't that I'm So Cool, I'm So Smart?
Yep, that's the one.
Yeah. But yeah, it's crazy fast.
And there's another one we forgot that has a similar thing.
But it's not like this ridiculous breakneck speed that it's like, you know, you're listening to a record and it's spinning too fast and you can't tell what the lyrics are. It's like it's going... It's like a podcast on 2X where you can get all the words in.
Yep.
And it's still fast, but you 100% can tell everything that was said, and it's perfectly clear. You don't, you know, you and I guess you might miss some things if you don't pay enough attention, or you slip, you know, you doze off or get distracted. But otherwise, it's totally good. And they manage, because of that speed, to cram in a ton of stuff, right? I didn't feel like there was anything that was like that they introduced. That was lacking screen. It's not like, oh, not too many characters, not enough characters, just right number of characters,
yep.
Just right number of, you know, scenes and twists and things like that.
Yep, like every side character, as crazy as they are, has just enough screen time for you to enjoy that character.
Yep.
Even like really minor characters, like they get enough.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone's like, Rotten Tomatoes, like this movie's making money. It's like the reviews are all great for the most part. What did Anime News Network say? Promare is a refinement of the Trigger formula to the point where I honestly believe it has outdone the classics that inspired it.
Yeah, probably. The only thing I can say about this movie that would be negative, besides the fact that the plot is basically nothing.
Yeah.
It's just anime plot, the anime. Right?
I like anime plot, the anime.
I do. I love anime plot, the anime. But relatedly... I think if you are
just
not,
like I like Guy Ritchie movie, the movie.
Right. I think if you are not anime fan, the weeb, this movie will just be like, what the fuck?
Yeah, because
like, this movie will just blast right. It might blow you away, right? Physically.
Yeah, but then
I don't think you're. You know, it's be not like, going to like penetrate.
If you a non-anime person, it'd be like a hurricane rolled through, and you're like just thrown around. And you don't
you're
know
like,
what's
what
going on.
What the fuck was that?
Yeah. Then it ends. You're just like, what?
Right. Whereas an anime fan would be, it's like. Well, it's imagine two people riding a roller coaster, and one person's like, "Woo, roller coaster!" And the other person's like, "Oh my god, what the fuck is this? I don't know what a roller coaster is."
Here's where I put it. Compare
Why
this.
Are we turning? Oh god!
Compare this to Redline,
and then one person gets off and is like, "That was awesome," and another person gets off and is like, "What the hell was that?"
Compare it to Redline, which is a pretty. Like,
I was also thinking about Redline, but I think Redline.
Redline
has
is actually sent like a normal movie,
right? Redline
has crazy.
Redline has more. Speed up and slow down, right? It's not full speed the whole movie.
Yeah.
Right? It's like there are the scenes where the racing and crazy racing action.
But then
happens.
There's the scenes where like the characters are developing and having a quiet night.
Right. And then there's talking in between, right? And there's a whole lot of setup before the race and stuff like that. Whereas
yeah.
Also, this is just nonstop.
To be fair, Redline actually has a pretty nuanced like set of character arcs, and the plot is actually pretty more complex.
Yeah, Redline has a plot that is way more advanced than the plot of Promare, which is just nothing.
Yep. But if I take like random person and show them Redline, they'll understand it as a movie.
Yes, a normal person can watch Redline.
Yeah,
only a weeb can watch Promare. I would be very surprised. I would love.
This is why I want to send this to my dad and be like, "Hey, Dad, it's a movie about firefighters from Japan."
They might hate you though, but I would love to just do like a test with like a room of non-weebs of various sorts of people, but non-weebs, and have them all watch Promare, maybe their first anime ever, and just see what the fuck they think about it. Like, kids might be like, "Woo!" But I think adults who have closed or minds might be like, "What the hell?"
Right. I mean, the first anime I ever saw was Vampire Hunter D, and all I remember is that I'd never encountered anything like that in my life.
No, it's a vampire story.
Yeah, but it was crazy, ultra gory. Like, it was way gorier than anything I'd really seen up to that point.
Yeah, it's true. It's Halloween time. Watch yourself a Vampire Hunter D.
Yeah.
If you haven't.
Do we ever review the original Vampire Hunter D?
I haven't watched it in forever. I remember, like, all I remember was there was, like, a...
Oh, Nighthawk.
Almost nothing.
Usually, every year around this time, Nighthawk Cinema will do a midnight screening with food.
But midnight, though.
On a weekend.
Yeah.
Bike there at midnight? That'll be fun. I'll do that.
Yeah, maybe.
So, yeah. if you are listening to this episode of Geek Nights,
that means you can probably go watch Promare as 100%. Soon as you get the opportunity.
If you are hearing these words, just stop listening and go find out how you right now can watch Promare.
You might have to wait for it to come out and stream to you or something like that. But
I almost just want to watch it right now.
We can't easily.
I'm sure I could find it somewhere.
It's possible, but difficult.
It might still even be in theaters in New York. I'll have to go check on that.
Maybe.
Yeah, this... You know, this movie does have more of a plot than the original Vampire Hunter D.
Maybe, but I'm still saying it really does not have, you know, a story.
Yeah, but this already, like, world was on fire. Why? Like, that's the plot. And at the end, you will know why the world burned down.
Right.
But and it's actually a pretty interesting plot that was more than I expected it to be.
Yeah, but it's not... You know, you're not getting any meaning or...
No, you could, because one of the aspects of this movie is actually very relevant. Well, two of the aspects are very relevant to current day, like, real world problems. The two things I'm thinking of are, one, anti-immigrant, anti-refugee, like, bullshit.
Yep.
And number two, rich people wanting to give up and start over and leave all the poors behind instead of using those resources to fix the world.
Yes.
Those are two very core, very real themes right. in this movie.
But they are just, they're just like put right out there.
Yeah. The plot is just, those anti-immigrant people are bad.
There is no,
Jeff Bezos, bad.
There is no subtlety whatsoever. There is no, right? It's literally just.
But that is still more.
I think they thought, when they made this movie, I think there was like an interview with them at the end. But they didn't say too much. But what it did come across like, we decided we wanted to make a Studio Trigger movie about fire. And then they pretty much just made up a plot in order to support the scenes that they wanted, including, like I said, robot so big it punches the earth that is entirely on fire and solar system
sets
on fire.
They even hinted at, because they were like, with Kill La Kill, we wanted to make a movie about clothes.
Yep.
And then they even corrected themselves.
Well,
like,
show
no.
about clothes.
Yeah, but then they corrected themselves. Like, well, actually about fabric.
Yeah.
Specifically fabric.
Yep.
So this is the fire movie.
Yep.
And it's great, and you should go see it, and we truly live in a golden age of animation. This has been Geek Nights with Rim and Scott. Special thanks to DJ Pretzel for the opening music, Kat Lee for web design, and Brando K for the logos.
Be sure to visit our website at frontrowcrew.com for show notes, discussion, news, and more.
Remember, Geek Nights is not one, but four different shows. SciTech Mondays, Gaming Tuesdays, Anime Comic Wednesdays, and Indiscriminate Thursdays.
Geek Nights is distributed under a Creative Commons Attribution 3.0 license. Geek Nights is recorded live with no studio and no audience. But unlike those other late shows, it's actually recorded at night.